Okay, so we will start with the viral skin diseases. Okay, so I think you can hear my voice. Okay, you can hear my voice. So today we will start with the first topic of viral skin diseases. First we will talk about is herpes simplex virus. Okay, so herpes simplex virus is mostly caused by herpes virus group of infections, and it involves two different viruses. That is, one is herpeviridae, first is the herpes simplex 1 virus, and second is the herpes simplex 2 virus. Okay, now the herpes simplex virus, as we all know, causes two types of herpes, that is herpes orolabialis or herpes labialis, most commonly we see, and second is the genital herpes infection. Now herpes virus infection, most important thing we have to understand is herpes virus is a DNA virus. Now DNA viruses have inherent affinity towards the nervous ganglion, specifically in herpes virus group. As we will see, in case of herpes zoster, it is involving the dorsal root ganglion or Gasserian ganglion or geniculate ganglion. Here in case of herpes simplex also, the virus leaves dormant in the VRG, that is ventral root ganglion, and the dorsal root ganglion. Now little bit about epidemiology. Second is the most important thing about pathophysiology of virus. Now to get a herpes virus infection, you need to have a active contact. So that's why herpes simplex is always included in sexually transmitted or transmitted by one person to another. Okay, so it's like, suppose somebody is having herpes simplex, okay, and he is having unprotected sexual contact with a partner. In those cases, the viral transmission can happen. But in cases where there is no direct contact, like uses of fomites or clothes, it is very unlikely that the virus will be transferred from one person to another. Okay. And usually what happens, the primary infection is usually asymptomatic in most of the cases, and it will, after that, the virus remains in a dormant phase. Suppose somebody has herpes, he got the infection from his partner, he will have infection, a asymptomatic disease, and then it will go into a latency. So unlike chickenpox, where the primary infection is symptomatic, in cases of herpes, the primary infection is asymptomatic. And herpes simplex virus is basically, the symptomatic disease is when there is a recurrence of the virus, when it is reactivating from the sensory ganglion, either it is dorsal root or ventral root ganglion. Now what are the precipitating factors? Now we know that somebody has got the infection, asymptomatic infection was there, then it was lying dormant. Now few of the factors which can cause reactivation of the virus are, it's like any change in immune status, stress on the body, drugs, or any other febrile illnesses which is causing indirect suppression of the immunity, like excessive exposure to UV rays. You can see herpes zoster in patients who are taking phototherapy, suppose in cases of psoriasis or vitiligo. Second thing is febrile illness. Febrile illness also, it's a very common condition. Usually you will see that patients after developing febrile illness, they comes with herpetic vitiligo. Herpes labialis. Okay. So suppose somebody has fever, after few days he will come with herpes labialis. Common cold, stress, exam related, very commonly we see GIT disturbance, and obviously immunosuppressions like HIV positivity, patients on steroids, leukemia cases who are on non-steroidal immunosuppressants like methotrexate and azathioprine. So usually clinical pictures, what is there? There will be, in the starting, there will be erythematous patch, small patch, usually around the, we will see the cases. Then group umbilical vessels, there will be pain, usually will be there, and it will heal with crusting by second and third week. So okay, so we will see some lesions. Okay, so see here, lesions are there. We can see in the, there are small patches are there presently over the mucosa. Okay, here we can see there are small vesicles, group vesicles present over the lower lip, and it will be associated with pain, and there will be some burning sensation usually will be there. Okay, so now clinical presentation most commonly is herpes labialis. Herpes labialis is the most common type of herpes simplex. Apart from it, gingival stomatitis, oral herpes simplex we can say, inside the oral mucosa it is happening. Then herpetic whitlow, we will discuss what is herpetic whitlow. Then ophthalmic, that is herpetic keratoconjunctivitis, and in pediatric age group there is dissemination of herpes simplex. Then herpes genitalis, that is caused by herpes simplex type 2 virus, and few of the types are eczema herpeticum and disseminated herpes simplex. We will see one by one in detail. So first is herpetic gingivostomatitis. What is stoma? It is oral cavity. So it is basically involves the gingiva and the oral cavity, and most commonly seen in pediatric age group. So we have to keep in mind. So if we see this kind of lesions in adults, we will suspecting a strong evidence of suppression of underlying immunity. So patient will be having what is most commonly associated with herpes virus group, that is swelling, redness, pain, bleeding, formation of vesicles, and there will be secondary infections can always be there because oral cavity is plethora of flora is present. So either candidal yeast infection, and this one is not there. Okay, so as we have discussed slightly back, we'll think about pathophysiology, epidemiology of herpes simplex. So we know it is double stranded virus type 1 and type 2. Type 1 causes herpes labialis, type 2 causes genital herpes. Okay, we know the precipitating factors. Okay, and we know the clinical pictures. So we'll start with herpes gingivostomatitis. So herpes gingivostomatitis is usually caused by herpes virus type 1, usually in pediatric age group. Okay, and vesicles will be present in, which will seen in the tongue, pharynx, palate, and buccal mucosa. And regional lymphadenopathy will also be there. Apart from it, tenderness, pain, and all the characteristic features of herpes virus infection, that is presence of vesicles, presence of erythema, redness will be there. And the fever will subside after 3-5 days, and recovery is usually completed by 2 weeks. So usually the condition is uneventful and is without complication, but yes, many times secondary bacterial and yeast, that is candidal infection, can happen over the primary herpetic gingival lesions. Okay, so that we have to keep mind. See here, we can see clear cut patches are there, redness are there, pain will be there. See, this is a secondary infected condition. Primary infection was there, then it got infected with secondary bacterial infection. Now second is the most common, is herpes labialis, also known as cold sore or fever blisters. Okay, so cold sore or fever blisters are nothing but or type of variant of mucocutaneous herpes simplex infection, and it is usually seen after some illness, some condition of stress, or patient who are undergoing taking medications like immunosuppression like corticosteroids. And the most annoying part or most debilitating part of this condition is that herpes labialis is a recurrent condition. Usually patients will have experiences at least 2 to 3 recurrences in a year. So those patients who are having a recurrent episodes of herpes labialis, there is increased propensity of developing pain over the lesions, and morbidities usually increase over the period of time. Although the number of vesicles will be fewer, but frequency, as the frequency increases, it causes a repeated phenomena in the patient which requires a long term suppressive therapy either with acyclovir or famciclovir, that we will discuss. Okay, now other conditions, complications which may lead to herpes labialis is presence of trigeminal neuralgia. Okay, and it may also give rise to in what we call erythema multiforme. So post herpetic erythema multiforme is one of the complications which may follow up after herpes labialis. So here we can see clear cut lesions. Some of the lesions are present over the lips and some of the lesions are present over the skin. Now there will be group of confluent vesicles, fluid filled vesicles present over the angle of the mouth associated with post lesion. Vaginal erythema, pain, and that is burning sensation. Okay, and usually some pre-dormal symptoms will be there. That is, patient will be might have some fever that has gone down, or patient will be having that is pain and redness will be there, and after that patient has developed the vesicles. Again, we can see characteristic group. grouped vesicles, small grouped vesicles over the angle of the mouth, mucocutaneous lesions. Okay. Then herpetic whitlow. What is herpetic whitlow? As we know that suppose that this patient is having herpes labialis and he is constantly touching his lip or the lesion with his hand. What will be there? There will be inoculation of the virus into the fingertip. So this inoculation of the virus into the fingertip will give rise to similar kind of symptoms present over the hand also. So somebody is constantly touching his herpes lesion over the lips, he will get over the hand also. And it is commonly seen in usually in dentist and ENT and in medical healthcare workers, because we tend to touch this kind of lesions either on the part of examination or accidentally. So that is also one of the common conditions which we will see in patients suffering from herpes simplex or in healthcare workers. Okay, sir, here how the whitlow has caused, the patient was having herpes gingivus stomatitis and kept on touching the lesion, giving rise to herpetic whitlow. The second part of the condition is caused by herpes simplex type 2 virus, that is herpes genitalis. Now herpes genitalis, as we all know, mostly is seen in sexually active persons, and it is one of the most common STDs nowadays. Okay, because of the advent of antibiotics, the bacterial STDs has gone down, and viral and non-bacterial, that is trichomonal infections, have increased like anything. So this usually increases herpes genitalis, the lesions usually increases with, as the more number of partners you have and more number of unprotected sex you have, more number of chances are there they will develop herpes genitalis. And most common, as same as herpes simplex, primary lesions will be asymptomatic, and usually the most common symptomatic lesions are reactivation of the lesions, and most commonly it will be present over the glans penis, shaft of the penis, scrotum and vertex, and females usually seen over the labia, perineum and thigh. See here, grouped vesicles, multiple grouped fluid filled vesicles present over a erythematous base, present with tenderness, pain and tenderness, present over the shaft of the penis. Now next condition is eczema herpeticum, or it is also known as Kaposi's variceliform eruption. Now what do you mean by eczema? Eczema means excoriation, inflammation. There is some disturbance of the normal continuity of skin, and herpeticum means like herpes. So it is superimposition of herpes simplex virus in atopic dermatitis. As we all know, atopic dermatitis is a debilitating skin condition defined by there is extensive scaling and crusting of the skin. If secondary herpes infection is, secondary herpes infection is occurring over the patient, there will be dissemination of the eczema present over all part of the herpes simplex. We will see one photograph to see it. See this patient. He was having atopic dermatitis, mainly distributed over the extensor part of the body, over the exposed part, and there was secondary inoculation of herpes virus. He might have developed herpes labialis, and from that herpes labialis disseminated infection is there. This condition is quite debilitating because patient itself is suffering from atopic dermatitis, and patient is again having secondary viral infection disseminated all over the body. So this conditions is usually difficult to diagnose, but a proper history taking and ruling out underlying conditions will help in clinching the diagnosis. So eczema herpeticum is characterized by always herpes virus will lead with fever, swelling, malaise, underlying lymphadenopathy, and there will be presence of multiple vesicles, crusting, oozing will be there, and be as the recurrences will be seen, as because all herpes virus do tend to recur, all herpes simplex usually tend to recur but usually the severity of the condition after the first recurrence is less. So usually the first incidence is more severe and follow-up recurrences will be less severe. Again, you can see atopic dermatitis, multiple fluid filled vesicles present over a erythematous base with crusting and scaling, with there will be presence of slight pus is also there. Because why this is happening? Because of the secondary bacterial infection. Now, disseminated herpes simplex is a serious condition and it is potentially fatal. Because why? Usually seen in HIV patients, but it can be seen in patients who are taking immunosuppressive, suppose transplant, suppose on high dose of steroid, okay, who are having skin failure like in erythema multiform, in cases of Stevens-Johnson syndrome, in cases of severe malnutrition. So these kind of patients, there will be widespread dissemination of the virus and there will be involvement of the virus to the inner organs like liver, kidney and ophthalmic involvement. So disseminated herpes simplex is a fatal condition and immediate treatment with antivirals have to be started, IV antivirals, to prevent further complication. Because we all know herpes simplex virus can cause meningitis, myelitis, myeloencephalitis and all other kind of systemic infections like serositis. Okay, so to prevent systemic complications, immediate antivirals has to be started. See, this case is a HIV positive male and presence of multiple hemorrhagic crust or necrotic lesions, and patient has liver, spleen and lung, that is EY, hepatitis, then pneumonitis, okay, and then meningitis was also there. So in this type of cases the chances of fatality is very high. Now, most importantly, diagnosis of herpes simplex. Most important part of diagnosis of herpes simplex is by Zanck smear. So how you do Zanck smear? Whenever you attend the clinical classes, I'll teach you how to do Zanck smear. You read about Zanck smear, okay. Zanck smear is basically nothing but we will take rupture a vesicle, take the cells from the base, we will make it a smear, fixed it, and we will see either Leishman's, either we'll do Leishman stain or any other stainings we will do, and we will see ballooning keratinocytes, presence of, okay, there will be presence of ballooning keratinocytes. This is a confirmation of acantholysis. Okay, apart from it, viral culture, always expensive method but very reliable method for diagnosis, and more easier than viral culture and much effective as viral culture is RT-PCR, that is reverse transcriptase. If suppose the patient is not, viral load is very low and you are not able to culture the virus, you can do RT-PCR, or RT-PCR will give good results even in very suspicious cases where viral load is very low, or atypical cases where your suspicion is on multiple diseases, not only on herpes simplex. See, Zanck smear, what we have done, we have cut the roof of the blister, scraping of base is but done, and we stain with either Leishman or Jimsa or Gomori's methamine silver, whatever stain you want to use. So we will see presence of multinucleated giant cells, okay, or ballooning giant cells, okay, we will see. The treatment of primary attack, again, either we can give acyclovir 200 mg 5 times a day or 400 mg TID. Again, suppressive therapy has to be given for long duration, that is 400 mg twice daily for at least up to 1 year we can give, so that we reduce the recurrences. Because what is happening, the virus is lying in the DRG or VRG, so the virus is dormant. So we have to clear the virus, and it is very difficult to reach the nervous tissue with normal medication, okay. So to reach the nervous tissue by eliminating the virus, we have to give acyclovir for a long duration, either 6 months, 8 months, even up to 1 year, we have to give acyclovir prophylaxis. If recurrences are more than 3 to 4 recurrences in a year. Now, second group of virus is the herpes group of virus. Now, herpes group of virus is mostly causing herpes zoster, that is zoster. So primary herpes is chickenpox is varicella, primary varicella, and reactivation of the virus is varicella zoster. So we will see the how the mode of transmission is there. Suppose this child, he has developed chickenpox. Now where the virus goes through the sensory ganglion into the DRG, that is dorsal root ganglion, and here it is lying dormant, latent with DNA. Again there is activation of the virus in DRG, either due to any conditions, stress, loss of immunity, drugs, anything, there will be activation of the virus on the sensory ganglion, and it will go up to the terminal part of the sensory ganglion, that is skin. So this is how actual the pathogenesis of is herpes zoster is happening. Herpes zoster is never a primary infection. It is the reactivation of the underlying infection. So epidemiology, age and factors, risk factors, so we all know, same as herpes simplex, that is immunotherapy, patient on HIV, okay, can also occur in patients receiving transplant, taking high dose of corticosteroids, after stress or any other stressful condition which may lead to loss of immune complex, that will give rise to herpes zoster. One more important thing is the diminished immunity with aging. So you have in the childhood, you have got chickenpox, and your immunity slowly builds up. After some time, what happens, your antibody is titer, tends to go down, IgM and IgG. Slowly the antibody titers goes down, so the virus gets a chance to reactivation. So usually what you will see herpes zoster in elderly patients who are suffering with diabetes, after 50, diabetes, all predisposing conditions. So all these cases you will see. So prodromal stage, again four stages, prodromal, acute vesiculation, crusting and post-herpetic neuralgia. So we have to treat the condition in prodromal stage itself, because we see that incubation period is very short, 3 to 5 stages. So once we see the prodromal, we have to start antiviral within 72 hours. Otherwise it will be of no use and patient will go into active vesiculations. Then only treatment we can start is secondary treatment or therapeutic. So preventive within 3 to 5 days, within prodromals, it is said easier than done, because the symptoms of herpes simplex is very complex. Many a times he would not be able to recognize. So herpes zoster. So that's why what is important is right diagnosis and proper understanding of the symptoms and anatomy of the virus in the ganglion. Okay. So skin lesions, there again presence of multiple grouped vesicles over erythematous base associated with pain. Only important part is segmental distribution. Although there is disseminated herpes zoster is there, but most commonly 95% you will see segmental herpes, that is involving one dermatome. So segmental herpes zoster is characteristic feature, and segmental involvement is characteristic feature of herpes zoster, and new lesions will keep on appearing for a week. Okay, see, so most commonly lesions are seen in what area is thoracic, then trigeminal over the face, and then lumbosacral and cervical area. This is how the distribution of herpes zoster is there. See here, presence of multiple fluid filled vesicles, grouped vesicles present over a erythematous base, surrounded by few discrete vesicles present over the periphery of the lesion, distributed in a dermatomal fashion or dermatomal pattern, present over the right arm. So what is your diagnosis? Your probable diagnosis is herpes zoster. Now what is this segment? This segment is which one? It is T1, then C8 and T1. Okay, so C along the ulnar nerve or along the radial nerve distribution. So thoracobrachialis. Okay, so hand and some part of thoracic lesion. Okay, that is there in case of herpes zoster. Here we can also see same dermatomal pattern. Okay, now again we can see this is same dermatomal pattern, it is reaching up to the nipples. Okay, here we can see dermatomal pattern is there, but it is present over the which part? Which is present over the forehead, or three divisions of trigeminal nerve are there, that is ophthalmic nerve. So one important point you have to remember is presence of Hutchison sign. What is Hutchison sign? Is presence of vesicles over the tip of the nose. If tip of the nose is involved, that means herpes zoster is involving the cornea, because tip of the nose and cornea both are involved by nasociliary nerve. So involvement of the tip of the nose is indication that cornea is also involved. So you have to examine the strict time examination. So this is sign is known as Hutchison sign. Okay. Now differential diagnosis, all we know, prodromal space is now associated with pain. So migraine, cardiac pleural disease in acute abdomen is there. Then is cutaneous eruption, that is herpes simplex viral infection. Then contact dermatitis, erysipelas, and bullous impetigo. These are all differential diagnosis. Now diagnosis will be almost as same as herpes simplex. First is clinical diagnosis is the major diagnosis confirmed by Zank test, and obviously PCR and viral culture you can do. More importantly, IgM of herpes simplex virus, viral culture to IgM, that also you can do varicella zoster virus to differentiate between herpes simplex and varicella zoster virus. Okay, now Zank smear you know how to do. Then treatment part, the treatment is most importantly, you have to start antiviral within 72 hours. Okay, acyclovir dose is higher, 800 mg 5 times a day. Then more importantly, you have to reduce the symptomatic cases, that is minimize the pain, give analgesic, that is ibuprofen or whatever you want to give. Second thing is that topical and systemic antibiotics if secondary infections has both happened. So you can do a betadine compresses or potassium permanganate compresses to reduce the vesiculations, to reduce itching and swelling, and also you can give oral amoxiclav and topical fusidic acid to relieve the infection. The complications are most importantly in this part, and this is the most important part about herpes simplex that we have to remember. It presents a post-herpetic neuralgia. Post-herpetic neuralgia, we will discuss one by one later. Then ophthalmic zoster, I think you have studied in your previous classes in ophthalmology. Ramsay-Hunt syndrome, again, one EMT topic. That is herpes zoster oticus. Then disseminated zoster and zoster encephalomyelitis. So all these things are usually what? These are complications of herpes zoster. So we will discuss about all these parts in your clinical classes. Okay, and tomorrow on next Friday we will also discuss about herpes zoster, because the topics are quite elaborate. So we will slowly discuss about these points. Now we go to the next part, that is warts. Warts are also known as verruca. So caused by human papilloma virus. Okay. So this is epidemiology, which is affecting childhood, because their immunity is modulating, all those things. Mode of transmission again, contact to contact. Okay. So it is also STD, because genital warts is most common type of STD. Causative agents, all different type of HPV are there. Common, that is from 1 to 33. So different types of HPV causes different type of warts. Now clinical presentation will go, which is we are more concerned about, that is common wart, that is verruca vulgaris. Then plain wart or verruca plana. Then plantar wart, verruca plantaris. Genital wart, condyloma acuminata. And filiform wart, or we can say it is filiform or plant like. Okay, some tree like projections. So filiform warts are there, we will see what are there. Then periungual warts and mosaic warts. So one by one we will see. common warts of varicose vulgare is most commonly caused by 1, 24, 26, 27. So there will be presence of multiple flat topped, skin colored to slightly pearly white, well defined papules and plaques distributed over the dorsal aspect of the skin. Okay, it may present over the hand, over the buttocks, any area it can present. Okay, and most important thing is that the surface will be rough with loss of dermatoglyphics. The skin markings will be lost. Okay, so this is how you differentiate between a wart and a plaque of some other conditions like psoriasis, or in cases of lichen planus, or in cases of prurigo nodularis, or in cases of lichen simplex. What happens in these cases, there will be loss of dermatoglyphics, all skin markings will be lost, whereas in cases of prurigo nodularis, lichen simplex, or any other lichenified lesion, there will be accentuation of dermatoglyphics with darkening, that is pigmentation. Here the pigmentation is gone, skin markings are gone. Okay, see how characteristic, so vast number of warts. Usually you will see this in HIV positive cases, there is presence of extensive warts will be there and pigmentation will be lost. Here we can see periungual warts. Okay, warts which have invaded the area around surrounding the nail bed. Okay, so paronychium, so there is invasion of the paronychium and invasion of the nail bed. These conditions are very difficult to treat because these kind of warts, they are present over the nail bed, presents over the, go up to the nail matrix, and whatever treatment you give, they come back. See, this is filiform warts, what I want to treat. There is projections, like thread like projections. Okay, see, small thread like projections are present over the face, over the nose. These are the most common sites you can see filiform warts. Now second is plain warts. Plain warts, varicose plana, it was 1, 2, 4, 26, 27, 28. Here it is 3, 10, 27, and 38. Okay, now the difference between plain warts, see, this is a varicose vulgaris and this is varicose plana. So difference between plain wart and varicose wart is, plain warts, they will be having a smooth surface, not as rough surface as varicose vulgaris. Okay, and plain warts are also commonly seen over the soft parts, like over the face, over the eyelid. Okay, and they usually cause multiple skin colored or light brown, slightly hyperpigmented small papules will be present, distributed discreetly over face, over the hands and legs. Okay, and any kind of shapes, usually round to oval is there, any kind of shape will be there. And one important thing is that Cobner's phenomenon, or we can say pseudocobner's phenomenon. Wherever you scratch, the wart will cause autoinoculation and new wart will come in a linear pattern, giving rise to the property of Cobner's phenomenon. Okay, and it will be also commonly seen around beard areas, because why, people go to the barbers, they get shaving done usually over the beard area through the safety razor what that barber is using. Now that safety razor, you have disinfected it with Dettol and all that, washed it, still some viral DNA can be present there, inoculating you, giving rise to plain warts. Here we can see multiple small discrete papules. Okay, slightly brownish color, no pain, no inflammation, and over the face here you can see so many lesions, and you see the skin markings are preserved. So very difficult to understand that very these are plain warts or lichenified plaques. Okay, so you have to always be very careful about the history, because usually warts will be non-itchy. Some patients, they might give history of itching, but usually that is a psychological or symptomatic itch, we can say non-physiological. Okay, itching. Then plain warts, plantar warts are present over the foot, dorsal of the foot, and most common species are 2 and 4. And most important, how we'll define presence of multiple well-defined scaly white plaques and papules distributed over the pressure area. Okay, why pressure area? Because it is always in contact with the floor, in contact with footwear. So here where the chances of getting the infection is there. Okay, and they usually coalesce to form a mosaic wart. See here, full they have coalesced to form a thickened plaque and mosaic wart. Okay, now apart from the plantar warts, we know that genital warts. Now genital warts, most common HPV infection are 6, 11, 16, 18, and this is the same serovar of HPV that is used for manufacturing of quadrivalent Gardasil vaccine. Okay, and they will have multiple cauliflower like growth, fungating growth, papules, nodules, plaque, everything can be present. Here we can see three well defined slightly pinkish to erythematous plaque with a cauliflower like projection present over the near the sulcus or over the dorsum of the penis. Okay, and usually it will be seen usually after 2 to 4 weeks of sexual contact, whereas in cases of condylomata latae, 2 weeks of sexual contact will see here. Here it is how it is happening. So condylomata latae that is caused by syphilis, within 2 weeks of syphilis infection, the condylomata latae develops, but condyloma acuminata usually will develop 4 to 6 months after primary infection. Here we can see small cauliflower like edematous present over the shaft of the penis. Okay, here we can see so many lesions, multiple skin colored to edematous lesions. Here is the anal wart, usually seen in patients who are having anal sex. Okay, they have anal wart around the perianal lesion. Okay, and protected anal sex usually in gay males. Okay, again same cauliflower like not slightly small projections are present. Okay, now course and prognosis. Here it we can say cervical wart. Now course and prognosis. Now usually we have to remember that warts are self-limiting condition. By 2 years, 70 to 80% of the warts will resolve. Okay, but in cases of immunocompromised patients, suppose HIV is on immunosuppressive drugs for organ transplantation, taking high dose steroids, or patients who are severely malnourished, this HPV infection can persist and it may become resistant to all kind of treatment modalities. Okay, so you have to be very careful to rule out any underlying pathology or any underlying condition which is causing compromise of the immune status of the patient. Now diagnosis of the wart, again most importantly is aceto whitening test. How we do? Suppose we are suspecting somebody is having invisible genital warts or invisible cervical warts, we will apply 3.5% acetic acid. It will cause presence of shiny white surface over the warty parts, whereas others normal skin cells will not stain with it. Okay, so this is one of the diagnosis we can do. Otherwise you can always send for a biopsy to do a confirmatory diagnosis. Polymerase chain reaction is again what we can say is a diagnostic tool basically. So suppose somebody is having wart, okay, we are not able to confirm the diagnosis, some dilemma is there, send it for PCR and send it for skin biopsy. That will confirm, clinch your diagnosis that this condition is indeed is a skin wart, not other some eczema or some other conditions. Okay, treatment, see, first line of treatment is removal of the lesions. That can be done by keratolytics like urea, lactic acid, salicylic acid, chemical cautery using TCA. Okay, you can cauterize the wart. Retinoic acid, retinoin again is causing keratolysis, so it is used in treatment of warts. Cryotherapy, burning of the warts using liquid nitrogen, electrocautery, tropical 5-fluorouracil, प्रोटोफायरिन 20% इमिकुमाब इज अगेन ए इम्यूनो मॉड्यूलेटर, वी विल डिस्कस इट लेटर, फॉर आई थिंक यू हैव स्टडीड अबाउट इमिकुमाब. इमिकुमाब इज नथिंग बट इट इज ए इम्यूनो मॉड्यूलेटर विच मॉड्यूलेट्स द इम्यून रिस्पॉन्स डिक्रीजिंग द प्रेजेंस ऑफ वाटर टिश्यू इन द स्किन. एंड लास्ट बट नॉट द लीस्ट, CO2 लेजर यू कैन डू ऑलवेज टू वेपराइज द वॉट्स. ओके, क्रायोथेरेपी लिक्विड नाइट्रोजन इज यूज 196 degrees माइनस सेल्सियस, हील्स विदाउट स्कैरिंग, कैन बी यूज टू ट्रीट ऑल काइंड ऑफ वॉट्स. सी हियर वी कैन सी. ओके, सो हियर हाउ दिस वॉज कैलोसिटी. ओके, देन लिक्विड नाइट्रोजन वॉज अप्लाइड, ड्यू टू एप्लीकेशन देर इज फ्रॉस्टिंग एंड देन इट विल थॉ ऑफ एंड फॉल ऑफ अगेन. सी हियर इन दिस कंडीशन हील्ड आफ्टर गिविंग ट्रीटमेंट. हियर वी कैन सी हियर वन वॉट वॉज देयर, हियर वी कैन सी नाउ इट इज गॉन. ओके, हियर वी कैन सी इन द हैंड्स द वॉट वॉज देयर, लिक्विड नाइट्रोजन वॉज अप्लाइड and throwing is happening. Okay, now podophyllin, as you all know, it's a podophyllotoxin, it's nothing but it's a mitotic poison. Okay, so one topical application we do, it causes inhibition of microtubules in the HPV infected keratinocytes. Usually the application is twice in a week, should be done with supervision of doctors, and it is not at all used in pregnancy. Okay, so this was all about warts. Last but not the least, we will talk about molluscum contagiosum. In short, molluscum contagiosum is caused by which virus? It is caused by double stranded DNA virus, and molluscum contagiosum is one of the largest known virus family in the plant animal kingdom, which causes diseases in humans. And as usual as for all the viral infections we have discussed, molluscum contagiosum again is spread by one person to other person, and very rarely by direct contacts. And then what are the clinical pictures? The incubation period is very variable. It may be from 4 weeks and up to any time, up to 6, even I have seen cases up to 4 months. So, and most importantly, it is asymptomatic. So suppose one child is there, he has molluscum contagiosum, he has picked it, some serous discharge is there, again one child is getting in contact, he will develop molluscum contagiosum. Size usually range from 2 to 10 millimeter, usually hundreds of lesions will be there, usually in childs over the face, because what you see, we will discuss with pics, you will see. This child might have one molluscum contagiosum, she has picked it and again she has touched the other part, so that virus laden fluid has got inoculated into other parts, giving rise to the virus. Okay, here we can see, again we can see umbilicated papules. Okay, now the lesion is described by presence of multiple well defined